Thanks for listening to the Adam Carolla Show on Podcast One.
Well, we got the news, always good, and Gary filling in, doing good sports. So that's coming. Gary doing a yeoman's job of good sports. First, Tommy John. Tommy John does not give an F. They give three Fs: fabric, fit, and function. Proprietary fabrics that perform like nothing you've ever worn before. No wedgie guaranteed. Comfortable, stay-put waistbands, luxurious, soft, feather-light, moisture-wicking, breathable fabrics designed to move with you. No bunching, no riding up. Look, if you don't love your first pair, and you will, I'm wearing mine right now, you will not go back to your former underpants or t-shirts or socks. It's all good. They make bras for the ladies. They make everything. And you can get it online, or you can go to over 1,200 retail locations across the country, including Nordstrom stores worldwide, or nationwide, I should say. But get a pair of these things. You'll never go back. It's the best. It's Tommy John, right, Dawson?
Hurry to TommyJohn.com/Adam for 20% off your first order. That's TommyJohn.com/Adam for 20% off. TommyJohn.com/Adam.
Bold statement. Saving money with Geico is almost better than watching football. Think about it. When you're watching the game, yelling at the quarterback to throw the ball, throw it, Williams is wide open, why are you doing this to me? Use that rocket arm, come on! They don't listen to you. But if you went into a Geico office and yelled, someone please help me save some money on car insurance, everyone would hop to it. Except the intern, because it's his first day and he doesn't even have a computer yet. See? Better. Switch and save with Geico. It's almost better than sports.
This November, see Amelia Clark.
You!
And Henry Golding.
I'm Tom.
Did you follow me?
Are elves always so cynical?
Relentlessly, these are dark times.
From Paul Feig, the director of Bridesmaids, comes the Christmas film of the decade.
Mom! You are very bad girl.
No call, no Twitter.
Yeah, okay.
I worry about you!
Featuring classic and never-before-heard music from George Michael.
I call that successful date. Fun, free.
Hey, you can't be in here!
Illegal.
Last Christmas, in cinemas November 15th, Certificate 12A.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gino Grad. Breaking viral, all those crazy Trump tweets. Give me news with Gina Grad. Trouble in the Middle East. Celebrity drunk meltdowns. Need news with Gina Grad.
The news with Gina Grad.
Well, Adam, you might want to head back to Utah, because just when you left, a new law took effect that allows higher alcohol beer, 5% alcohol by volume, to be sold in Utah grocery stores and convenience stores and on tap in restaurants and bars. To commemorate this event, Budweiser sent its Clydesdales to ceremoniously bid goodbye to the remaining 3.2% beer. There's a big parade down Main Street. There they are. Under the new law, Utah residents will be able to enjoy the same Budweiser recipe that everybody else gets in the U.S. And do you guys want to take a guess at the only state left in the United States to cap alcohol concentration at 3.2? And I had no idea. That's specifically for gas stations and supermarkets. And I would think that this state enjoys their beer.
This is my Southwest rule. Mm. Like, we were on Jet Suite X yesterday, and it was so easy. You know, because the airport, LAX, security, fucking Uber, buses, people sending, people waiting in line for Ubers and stuff. Like, it's such, LA, the flight is just self-imposed hassle. Mm-hmm. Like, all we do in LA, what we do in LA is we do a self-imposed hassle. Yeah. Like, hey, honest taxpayer who's not affiliated with ISIS, we're going to hassle your ass till you're so fucking aggravated that, like, it becomes such a, it's literally, if you want to go to Vegas or Phoenix or Salt Lake City and you want to leave LAX and come back to LAX, the airport part is the much longer, cumbersome part than the actual flight.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Totally. Okay. That's bad.
A flight's easy.
That's bad. Yep. That's a bad thing. And you do Jet Suite X, and it's like, hey, you pull right in, you walk right in, you nothing,
it's zero. It's a dream.
It's a dream. It's a dream. And as we're, like, flying back, I'm like, look, when Jet Suite X moves, you know, starts servicing Denver or starts servicing Utah.
Hey, all right, fellas, turn the mic down. I think Dawson.
Kalen, we can hear you.
Someone's back is up.
Yeah. It's a weird thing that happens as much as it does. But anyway, I said, as we're landing, 1 hour, like all in on both sides, security, whatever, easy. So I said, look, when they start doing Denver, start servicing Denver or Utah, I'm just going to fucking move because it's easy now. It's if you eliminate the airport, you eliminate fucking LAX, yeah. And you walk through and you get rid of that part, then it's just, we talked about getting work done on the plane. You got a 70-minute flight or whatever it is. Now that the world is opened up, now that this country is opened up, you know, Southwest is flying everywhere all the time. We must now do a standard alcohol thing, age of consent. Like there must
all the important shit.
All the super, and I'd like to mix the two.
Yes, you know what I mean? Meet at 13.
I will cross pollinate.
Super yeah. strong beers.
Let's call it 13. Yeah. Let's call it 13. One number, one standard.
Easy to remember.
Easy to remember. So no, what I'm saying is these things used to have to take a fucking ox with a cart on it to get to Oregon. It took you 7 weeks and four family members would die. There's too much travel.
Right.
It's too easy. It now must be universal. Do you see what I'm saying? We're all connected. Yeah. It takes a fucking village. Like when I flew back from Utah, and you, again, like you go or you're in Utah or you're in New York or you're wherever you are. You go to New York. It's like, hey, I pull over at the bodega. I want to get a bottle of wine. No, you have to go to a wine store. All right. Well, then go to the Whole Foods. I want to get a bottle of wine. You can't buy a bottle of wine. You can buy beer at the Whole Foods in Manhattan.
Yep.
You're in Manhattan. You're in a
Where
Whole
anything's
Foods.
Possible.
You're in a Whole Foods in Manhattan and you can't buy a bottle of Chardonnay.
Dumb.
It's dumb.
Yeah.
Like, okay. And also, not only dumb, but to the guy who likes to have a little wine before he goes to bed, and Whole Foods is open till 10, and the wine store closes at 8 or whatever. I just walk into the Whole Foods, like, where's the wine? Like, you do not get your medicine. It is not here. We just need to open everything up and just sort of standardize it. You know, you go to Utah, you go into the bar on Sunday, you're like, I'll have a Bloody Mary. Like, we don't do Bloody Marys until, you know, it's like, it's too much.
Yeah.
And this sort of thing where you're going from a 4.0 to a 5.0, just let all the rules around it, just standardize everything. Can we agree that these things were fine when people couldn't move around?
Yeah,
like they move around.
It took 3 days to get to the other end of the state.
Right. Now it's too fast, it's too easy, and there's too much of it going on. You're going back and forth, and you need to be coached up on what's going on. Like, I mean, we went in one day. We went to the, you know, Oktoberfest ski chalet where you want that big boot of beer, but not 4.0.
Yeah.
And then later on, I was at a sports bar, the other place where you'd like a nice frosty from the tap. Now, but if I would have stayed another day and a half, then it would have kicked up a point. It's just knock it off.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, there's one state left in the nation that caps at 3.2 for beer sold in gas stations and supermarkets. Any guesses, or would you like me to reveal?
I don't know.
Maine.
Wisconsin.
Minnesota. Those people are hearty drinkers.
I will say this, too, about Utah. For everybody, or at least Salt Lake City, for every Mormon there is out there, there are five freaks with tattoos all over them.
Like, gotta keep the balance.
The other side goes the other direction hard. Freaks. You can tell who's Mormon and not Mormon. You don't have to talk to anybody. You just look at them and you go, that chick's got the barbell going through her nose and the sleeve completely sleeved
not
up.
Not a Latter-day Saint?
No. Okay. We saw the guy who had the tattoo, which was just black arm.
It's like a solid sleeve, just solid black.
No. Wow.
No. I'm telling you,
sleeve.
The people that have rejected the religion have gone hard the other way.
Oh, yeah. They're sending a message.
Yeah. There is religious folks and freaks. There's not a lot of sort of what we'd call in between. They got like pushed into that. Yeah.
I did not know that.
Oh, yeah.
Why not Sunday?
Yeah. Why not Sunday?
Well, here's a couple of celebrity breakup stories. Rosie O'Donnell may not be spending the holidays with her fiancé this year. She reportedly split from Elizabeth Rooney after 2 years of dating. That's according to Radar. A source says she hasn't mentioned Rooney in a while. Further proof, a glance at the police officer, her fiancé's, Instagram shows all photos of Rosie have been deleted. All mentions of their engagement have been deleted. O'Donnell was married to Kelly Carpenter from 2004 to 2007 and Michelle Rounds from 2012 to 2016. And
imagine being married to Rosie O'Donnell. Like,
oh no, I don't want to do that.
Work
I don't want
that
to
would be
that.
Like how different. How what?
You're walking on eggshells probably half the time.
I mean, just imagine the crazy highs and the lows and the rage and all the stuff she would internalize that was the nothing. You know, it was a nothing burger. Like that just seems like a full-time job.
When it's good, it's good. But when it's bad, oh boy, run.
Yeah.
Well, also, Ian Ziering leaving his wife of 9 years. Now, the reason I bring this up is because their announcements about this, very different. Mm. His announcement on Instagram said, "It is with a heavy heart that I tell you Aaron and I are splitting up. With our hectic work schedules, we could not be busier. And over the last years, we've grown apart." Aaron's Instagram said this. "After 9.5 years of marriage, Ian asked for a divorce. Having asked multiple times, I knew it was time to give up. Knowing that I'm not the person to make him happy makes the situation more peaceful." Sources say they were fighting a lot. Ugly split.
There's no... Is there such a thing as we both work too much so we can't be together?
I think that's pretty typical.
No,
really?
That's what they say.
Oh, I mean, a typical reason. Given.
I mean, like if Lynette was like a super, like if she was like Mark Garagos and just like bringing home sacks of money, I'd be like, oh, all right,
make it work.
You gotta be in New York on a Wednesday.
Right.
I'll be here when you come back.
Yeah,
I could handle that. Like, who is it ever really the reason? Like,
authentic.
When a chick says, you know, I'm really focusing on my studies right now. Yeah. I don't have time to date. Would that be the answer if George Clooney wanted a date?
No, you know what I'm saying?
Like, are any couples, if you're both really busy and both really doing your career thing, then you're really successful.
Mm.
And I get the part where, you know, somebody goes to Atlanta to shoot a movie for 3 months and like never comes back. Oh, that can be tough. But I'm just talking about
servicemen
sort of staying in town, people go out on oil. Every movie I've ever seen where a guy goes out to an oil rig out on a platform in the ocean, his wife loves the shit out of him. They fucking can't wait for that guy to get home.
Counting the days.
Yeah. Always happy. Drives him to the port, you know? Right.
You know, it's another cliche, which I think is actually absolutely true, because it happens so often, and you don't often hear about it, but like when someone starts off at a certain level of success and fame and gets married and then rockets up, you know what I'm saying? I'm just saying, Sharknado 1 was 6 years ago, and they'd been married for 3 years, and not that that is the pinnacle, but Bryan Ziering is far more successful today than he was 9 years. You know what I mean? 9 years ago.
Oh, 9 years ago, I remember clearly because you know I watch Beverly Hills 90210 or whatever it was. Or
Steve,
I watch those shows.
I always watch those
shows.
I have no idea.
I like bad shows, and I watch those shows. I watch Melrose Place. You know, I'd watch all that stuff, and so those guys were super successful when I was swinging a hammer for $14 an hour. So they always looked that way. And so I remember once when I was doing my sitcom, this is right about the time Brian got his tumor was diagnosed. I was working with an acting coach at a place in Hollywood, like go there once a week, work out the stuff, the studio, network just paid for it. You know, like, talk to this lady. Mm-hmm. And I said, okay. And then one time I went in and the acting coach said, we workshopped your script. And we got the script. We got some of our actors and we put it up on his feet. And we kind of workshopped it or something. Okay. And I said, oh, that's cool. And then I said, I don't know. I think she volunteered it. I don't think I asked. She said, Ian Ziering played you. And I remember going, what's he playing me for? I should be playing him. Yeah. Like, what's happened to Ian Ziering that he's workshopping my script?
Those pre Sharknado days.
Yeah.
That's like, I don't want to live in a world where Dennis Prager knows who I am.
Yes, that's the way I feel. Like, he shouldn't have heard of me.
No, absolutely.
I don't want to live in that world. And I don't want to live in a world where Ian Ziering is playing me in a sitcom pilot who doesn't get to play me in a sitcom pilot.
He's the practice version.
Yeah. I remember thinking, boy, you bottomed out. Then, on the happy note, I think my mom has found a new celebrity to adore.
Oh, who?
Will be Ian Ziering 10 right. years ago because he's bottomed out.
Right.
Because so he's playing me, which means he's bottomed out versus Jon Stewart, who's really good on Oprah.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yes. That's all you need to know about my mom, everybody.
Well, keeping the celebrity rumor train going, remember when we talked about Ben Affleck getting pretty wasted and winning $1,500 at the Commerce Casino?
Bring that up to Matt Damon.
Yeah.
I shall.
This is something that you should check in with him about. Apparently, that story wasn't totally true. A little bit different. Contrary to those reports.
He didn't win?
Well, he didn't win muchly. In Touch Weekly says he actually lost $60,000 in 40 minutes, according to an onlooker. An onlooker said everyone was just staring at him. They couldn't believe it. He refused to fold. So many people were just taking his money. One thing that isn't in dispute he was drunk. Another source says Ben was so obviously drunk, his hair was messed up, he was having trouble walking and talking, his eyes were half closed. I tried to talk to him at one point, but he was incoherent. And then Ben says, this happens, it's a slip, I'm not going to let it derail me.
The
part, 60 grand, 40 minutes.
You know, you're not allowed to operate a motor vehicle when you're drunk. Should be allowed to gamble heavily when you're
completely
sauced.
Or the strip club.
Yeah, you can't sign a contract if you're impaired.
Yeah, I mean, the idea that you go to Vegas and they bring drinks to the table, and the only thing that's free is those drinks when you're sitting at that table. In a way, you're basically, because look, they say, like, you're impaired. Mm-hmm. Your decision making is impaired. Mm-hmm. And I don't think a sober Ben doubles down on those hands.
No.
He folds those hands. Like a sober version of him knows how to play, but you're impaired. Yep. And thus, the 60 grand, I'm guessing they were bringing drinks to the table.
I would imagine. I've been at casinos where people have been passing out, like nodding off, passing out because they're tired and drunk, whatever. Do you think they asked them to leave? Of course not. They're encouraging them. Like, sir, it's your turn. Sir, it's your play.
Yeah, I'm not. I don't like a world with more regulation. I'm just saying. See, here's the way I work. My world is like, all right, well, if you're allowed to play blackjack drunk, then you should be allowed to do a lot of other stuff drunk. It's not outlaw blackjack.
Right.
It's open it up at the beach. I should be able to walk along the beach shit-faced and not get hassled if you're allowed to gamble away tens of thousands of dollars.
Ride a jet ski.
That's right.
Do the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
So HBO is greenlighting a new Game of Thrones prequel, and that's not news because we knew that was going to happen, but it's because they're canceling the one that we thought was going forward with Naomi Watts. HBO says it has given a 10-episode order to a new one, not the one with Naomi Watts, a new one called House of the Dragon, set 300 years before the original series takes place. The prequel's based on George R.R. Martin's Fire and Blood. HBO declined to comment on reports that it had dropped the other Game of Thrones prequel that was set thousands of years before the original, a pilot episode starring Naomi Watts.
Is Game of Thrones set in any time?
It's like in yesteryear. They don't say specifically. It's in dragon times.
Is it like the Bud Light commercials?
Yes, exactly.
Is that when it's set in?
Pretty much.
Long ago and far away. They already shot the Naomi Watts pilot in Northern Ireland. And if there's any indication, the pilot for the original Game of Thrones was like $10 million. So something had to go so wrong that they just scrap the entire thing?
They do it all the time. I mean, I don't know if they're still doing it this way, but, you know, back to Ian Ziering and pilot season, they'd order 18 pilots, and they'd pick up two of them.
Yeah.
And each pilot cost $3 million.
That's true.
Like, and they just throw them away. I always thought they should have the pilot channel. You could watch my pilots. You could watch other pilots. Yeah. They'd have a bunch of old, you know, you could see a 23-year-old Tim Allen.
That's a great idea.
You know, like all these young celebs and different, they all have failed pilots.
I had that same idea on this podcast five years ago. I'm like, why not just package the pilots? They're yours.
I would love to watch that channel.
Who wouldn't want to, like, a young George Clooney or whoever.
They never pull them out. The reason they never pull them out is because, well, first off, if the ones they pick don't work, like every time
God forbid it's a good one.
I've done a pilot, they've passed, you know, NBC, I think they passed on The Man Show and they ordered Cupid. Jeremy Piven plays Cupid.
I love that show.
It didn't work out. And then when I did one on NBC or whatever, they pulled out, like, they did another season of a Jay Moore thing that didn't work. Like, there's all the stuff that they shows over right. years didn't really work.
So they, it, there's nothing in it for the network to shed a light on the things that they passed on.
I don't know, but I will tell you this. What I've learned about Hollywood is you do a killer pilot or a good pilot or a strong pilot. And for whatever reason, sensibilities, politics, timing, what have you, it gets scrapped. Mm. Like I did a pilot for Top Gear USA because they brought back Knight Rider. Mm.
And it didn't work.
Somebody brought back Knight Rider.
And then
they brought back
car shows are blackballed.
The worst show of the 80s. They brought it back, and then it tanked horribly because, of course, it's going to tank horribly. It's Knight Rider.
All
and
of our cars are like Kit now.
Well, we're not even going to look at your Top Gear pilot, which is really good because we're not doing any car shows. Yeah. That's kind of how the business works. Mm. And you could then go, okay, ABC, let's go over to CBS with it. And CBS will go, I don't want it if they passed on it. It's like, well, they passed on a good...
Right. That's neither here nor there.
Is it any surprise that after, you know, decades of that kind of thinking, systemic thinking, that like the AMCs and the whoever and the Netflixes are just shoving it up the network's asses now with like quality content?
Oh my God. Oh my God.
It's the most knee-jerk
reaction.
You're
so right. I know. All right. Sorry. Where?
So here's some more entertainment news that I'm very curious to get both of your takes on. The Bee Gees have a biopic deal because it is biopic time
I rightfully predict this. You're going to see about every fucking band you've ever heard of.
Exactly. So Paramount Pictures just purchased the rights to the stories of Barry, Robin, and Maurice, and Bohemian Rhapsody producer Graham King will head the creative team. Over the course of 40 years, Trio sold more than 200 million records worldwide while reinventing themselves, pop harmonists, rhythmic rockers, en route to their induction in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Paramount, which used the Bee Gees to score Saturday Night Fever, enjoyed their recent success with the Elton John biopic Rocket Man, so Brian's right. These are going to come in hot.
We don't
for
have
a while.
Any talent attached to this. It's just a Bee Gees biopic.
Well,
it can be good.
This is the opposite of pulling Top Gear because Knight Rider didn't work. I mean, this is the other version of that. We need more of these.
Right.
Or none of that.
Right.
So that's the way it works.
Telling you here and now, these are the next superhero movies. Now that the Marvel thing is kind of fading a little bit.
The way this world works as well, like we have Ford v. Ferrari coming out. Mm. I make automotive docs. We all have our fingers crossed. If this thing flies, then our phone's going to ring. Mm-hmm. And if it tanks, then nobody's going to want any of our stuff. That's the way stupid Hollywood works.
Yep.
It's the way any business would work if the people who made decisions didn't know anything. You know what I mean? Like the chick at NBC when I was doing a doc, she didn't know anything about comedy. She's not funny. I am telling you, if you got everyone who went to high school with her and said, guess who's heading up the comedy division at NBC, Nina Tassler, whatever, they'd all go, that sourpuss? Like, she wasn't even... She never made anyone laugh. Like, what? Why is she heading up this division?
Yeah.
All right. I got to tell you, I don't know, back to Bud Light. They got to bring... somebody sent me the giant taco salad maker.
Yep.
Goddamn that. Taco salad. Find Real Men of Genius taco salad. I'll do I'll hit legalism. It is funny. Straight on through.
I'm surprised they never got offered some sort of a weird off, you know, spinoff pilot.
Yeah, like
of some
the
kind.
Cavemen.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, let me hit the legal zoom. Running your own business isn't easy. Get help with the day-to-day challenges. Over the past 18 years, LegalZoom helped more than 2 million business owners get started. But every entrepreneur knows that starting the business is just the beginning. That's where LegalZoom, network of independent attorneys, that's where they come in. They have tax professionals that can help with advice on trademarks, tax law, changes in tax law, reviewing contracts. You'll save money by avoiding the hourly fees. Oh, man. Gergis. They'll stick it to you with those. Gergis tells people, go get it at LegalZoom. Gergis uses LegalZoom for stuff because if you can just do it a la carte, it's cheaper. They're not a law firm. They don't get distracted by legal hurdles and business questions as this year winds down. Hit up LegalZoom, right, Dawson? All right, we'll play the giant taco salad maker. It's so funny.
Bud Light presents Real Men of Genius. of genius.
Today we salute you, Mr. Giant Taco Salad Inventor.
Mr. Giant Taco Salad Inventor.
Ground beef, refried beans, guacamole, cheese, sour cream, and if there's any room left, a few shreds of lettuce.
I don't see no lettuce.
A culinary creation that baffles the human mind. A 12,000 calorie salad.
Caramba.
Some may ask, is your taco salad healthy? Of course it is. It's a salad, isn't it?
You can eat that deep fried crunchy bowl.
So crack open a nice cold Bud Light, conquistador of the calorie. You put the feast in fiesta.
Mr. Giant Taco Salad Inventor.
It's funny all the way through.
We got to have Christy come and talk about these sometimes.
Oh,
this
that'd
was
be
the
great.
Rare campaign that worked perfectly as radio and
right.
really didn't cross over to TV. I didn't realize there even was a TV version of this. Like,
yeah.
I remember it from the radio, and there were dozens of them. They were great.
They were so good. My favorite, one of my favorite lines is, you know, Mr. Roller Cooler Cooler Roller. He says, you have everything you need except a friend to help you carry your cooler.
It's so good. And you're right. Work something that will work audibly solely.
Yep.
And that does not drop off comedically at all and can work visually as well. That's a tough task. All right, Gina Grad, let's bring it home.
You
shall
got
we?
It. Sure. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news.
Gina Grad!
That was the news with Gina Grad.
Last but not least, Castrol Edge, stronger under pressure. Get the edge with Castrol Edge. Three times stronger.
Three times, fool.
Cool than leading full synthetic. It is Castrol Edge. All right, let's see. Oh, I'm going to be playing the Pabst Theater
All
in Milwaukee.
Right.
Speaking of beers, that'll be January, and then coming up at Park West in Chicago. That's in January, too.
Going to two very cold places in January.
Go to Adam Carolla.
I know. Put the beers outside.
Mike, can't we go to Winnipeg and get a break? Mike sent me to Winnipeg in January. It's the coldest place in Canada. In Canada. It's cold for Canada.
But it was during a heat wave. Remember, they said it's -5. This is the warmest it's been in a month.
Get your swim trunks.
Yeah. All right.
Heat wave.
-5. Check out nosafespaces.com. Check out our comedy channel, youtube.com/AdamCarolla. Yes.
We'll do a full recap of Laughs of the Ball Bryan tomorrow. We record this on a Friday before, you know. So.
Yes. Go to AdamCarolla.com for everything you need. Good sports coming up next. Until next time, it's Adam Carolla for James Mangold and Christian Bale and Matt Damon and Gina Grad, Ball Bryan saying mahalo.
Fire and blood.
As we watched the suburban garden gnome carefully without disturbing it, we noticed that it moves like not at all. It's inanimate and utterly without brain function. But despite that, when a garden gnome hears about how Geico not only saves people money, but also gives them access to licensed agents 24/7 online and over the phone, it's clear to them you should switch. Because yes, switching to Geico is a no-brainer. But on second thoughts, maybe don't watch garden gnomes too carefully. People might talk.
This November, see Amelia Clark.
You!
And Henry Golding.
I'm Tom.
Did you follow me?
Are elves always so cynical?
Relentlessly, these are dark times.
From Paul Feig, the director of Bridesmaids, comes the Christmas film of the decade.
Mom!
You are very bad girl.
No call, no Twitter.
Yeah, okay.
I worry about you!
Featuring classic and never-before-heard music from George Michael.
I call that successful date. Fun, free.
Hey, you can't be in here!
Illegal.
Last Christmas. In cinemas November 15th. Certificate 12A.
Ace and Shecky, let's do it. Good sport.
The Podcast One Sports Network presents Good Sports.
Hi and hello, sports fans, and welcome to this week's episode of Good Sports. With you this week, Gary Smith, and as always, Adam Carolla.
Hey, man.
Hey, man. Dave Damashek could not be here this week. We ran into a little traffic problem with some of the fires in L.A., so I'm going to sit in and try to fill his shoes amicably.
Yeah, you can do that.
We'll see. I hope so. Hey, did you hear about this recent football recruit that was committed to LSU? I thought you might be interested in his name. Gentleman's name is DeColdest Crawford.
Oh, somebody tweeted me. Yeah, they said, like, move over to Brickashaw.
Right.
There's DeColdis Crawford.
And according to an interview I read with him, he said that his mom came up with the name and that it was because she knew he would be the best athlete out of his entire family. So for those who may not be aware, coldest is kind of slang for the coolest.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's the opposite of being lit, although it means the same thing.
Correct.
So it's cold. One is ice, the other is fire. They're both good.
Yeah, there is a DeColdis right there up on the screen. He committed to LSU, and he said he's always dreamed about playing college football. I mean, where does this rank for you with the all-time great football player names?
Well, as Sheck brought up a few episodes ago, the all-time best name. The whole thing about a best name is it's not all about all the syllables in it. You know, some of it's simple, like baseball player Bake McBride is just an awesome name. I mean, yeah. The guy's name is Bake McBride, and it wouldn't work if his name was Bake Higginstaller. It's Bake McBride. It's got a roll, like it has to have a cadence. Look, the all-time best name of all time is someone, Doug DeLuca, I used to work with at the Man Show, went to high school with in New Jersey. It was a gal by the name of Nachilla. That is the best all-time name. Now, it's not the best all-time sports name. It's just the best all-time name. I don't know, man. DeColdis is fine, but I'll take DeBrickashaw over DeColdis. And then what's the last name? Because that factors in. Like, again, Bake McBride is great, but Bake Higginstaller is not good.
DeColdis Crawford.
It's good. You have the sort of alliteration thing going. Or you have the Cole and Crawford. It's strong. Yes.
His middle name is To Ever Do It. So it's DeColdis To Ever Do It, Crawford.
At some point, it becomes child abuse, right? Like, also, can we have, you know, the DMV, I couldn't have a vanity license plate. I couldn't have what do they give you? 7 characters on a license plate? Like, I couldn't go to the DMV and go, I want JEWOVEN. Okay? And they'd go, what? I go, yeah, Jew oven. And they'd go, no.
Yeah.
They just go, no. And I could say, my name is Jew oven. Like, my family's name is Jew oven. Like, I'm Bob Jew oven. And it's like, they'd go, no.
Yeah.
They just go, no. So I don't know at what point.
The coldest to ever do it.
What I'm saying is, like, when you go to the Hall of Records or you're at the hospital and you're like, I want to name my kid Fucky McFuckstick. And it's like, they'd go, no.
Yeah.
So at what point do they go, no? Like, I remember I did that with Jimmy once. Like, I was doing a. I was talking to him about, like, when I started with Jimmy on K-Rock, I had a lot of ideas about, like, what I could say on the air and what I couldn't say on the air. And then he had a lot of ideas about what I could say on the air and what I couldn't say on the air. And I was like, if you can say bazoombas and jugs and Winnebagos and boobies, why can't you say titties? And he's like, you can't say titties. I'm like, you can say, you have to be able to say titties. You can say jugs, you got to say titties, you know? And we'd argue a lot. And I remember once I said, well, what if someone's reviewing a Bond movie and they talk about pussy galore?
Sure.
It just said pussy galore. And I was doing this joke with this Bond villain named Koozie McVulva. Or something. And he said, you can't say Koozie McVulva. I said, you can say pussy galore. I can say, and he said, like, well, you think you can say Fucky McFuckstick? And I was like, no. And he's like, okay. That's his argument. So there has to be a vetting process.
Yeah.
And at some point, if we can agree that you can't name your kid Fucky McFuckstick, then where do you draw the line? Where does somebody go, you can't do that? Or when does the state go, like, the license plate? You can't have that on a license plate.
Yeah, there's got to be a deciding factor, you know, some sort of governing body.
I would think. But on the other hand, This is a pretty crazy name to whoever's at the hospital. Or, I mean, somebody must review the paperwork, right?
I don't know. I recently went through this, and there didn't seem to be a lot of review. I was the only one kind of triple checking that, and you know, they seemed anything you scratched out there, they seemed okay with.
So you go to the DMV, you're getting your license renewed.
Right.
It says "Fucky McFuckstick" on your license, but on your license plate, you can't get. You're not PG-13.
No.
You're PG or G. You can't get near anything that sounds like anything.
Just to illustrate your point, I read a story recently about a geologist who was trying to get I-L-O-V-E-R-X for his license plate. I love rocks. But because of the prescription connotation with RX, they thought it was saying I love drugs, and he was in a long, protracted fight with the state trying to get that approved.
Yeah, but what if you're a pharmacist?
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Wouldn't that be like, that's your job? It's just this RX in front of the counter?
That's someone's job to...
All right, so I love RX it's not even PG. It's G-rated,
right,
or whatever. It shouldn't be controversial, and I get it. They flagged it, whatever. But what's this kid's name again? His middle name?
The coldest to ever do it, Crawford.
Yeah. That's not good. And then you always run the risk of, what if that's on his Home Depot badge?
Yeah.
That's the scary part. That's why smart. See, here's the whole thing about the name. Let the kid earn it. Just give him a regular name. Like, I know Bill Simmons and I know Jimmy Kimmel, and these are just regular named guys. And then they went out and earned their name.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. You don't want, yeah, you make it generic enough that they can pave their own way.
I have this theory that if you give people, it's part and parcel of my hot chicks in high school and dudes that look good in their underpants in high school don't quite get the work ethic. I think there's a little bit of a coasting. When you have a cool and unique name that's a kind of a conversation piece, you don't go out and earn it. All right, let me hit Geico. Everyone's got the to-do list. How about you, Ed? Save hundreds of dollars on your car insurance. And you don't have to go anywhere. Just go to geico.com. 15 minutes. You could be saving 15% or more on your auto insurance. Take that extra money, put it in your pocket. All the money, plus the money you save getting your vanity plate rejected. You put that together with your Geico money, you buy yourself a new car. Be the most rewarding thing you do all day. That is Geico, geico.com.
Well, that does it for this today's episode of Good Sports. You can tune in tomorrow. We will be back with more Good Sports action. And until then, for Adam Carolla, Gary Smith, out. Good Sports.
Show on Twitter at Adam Carolla Show. Follow the Ace Man on Twitter at Adam Carolla. And the show across all other platforms at Adam Carolla. For tickets and info on all the live podcasts, Mangree events, books, movies, and more, visit AdamCarolla.com.
Bold statement. Saving money with Geico is almost better than watching football. Think about it. When you're watching the game, yelling at the quarterback to throw the ball, throw it, Williams is wide open, why are you doing this to me? Use that rocket arm, come on! They don't listen to you. But if you went into a Geico office and yelled, "Someone please help me save some money on car insurance," everyone would hop to it. Except the intern, because it's his first day and he doesn't even have a computer yet. See? Better. Switch and save with Geico. It's almost better than sports.